The theme of this session is accessibility. Accessibility in a law reform context can mean many things, and we have deliberately left the topic broad to allow each of these excellent speakers to articulate their own perspective on what we as a law reform community should be focusing on when we turn our mind to accessibility. As you will see, there is an opportunity for questions at the end of hearing from all five speakers today. And it's with great pleasure that I invite the Chief Parliamentary Counsel, Fiona Leonard, to begin this discussion.
Ngā mihi ki a koutou. It's both a privilege and a pleasure to be asked to present at this symposium to mark the Law Commission's 30th anniversary. The Law Commission and the Parliamentary Council Office have a very long history of working together to improve New Zealand's laws. Our officers worked closely together on the development of the legislation guidelines and as members of the former Legislation Advisory Committee. The Parliamentary Council Office has worked with the Law Commission to produce draft bills or provisions to include in Law Commission discussion documents and reports. In 2009, the Law Commission published a report in conjunction with the Parliamentary Council Office on the presentation of statute law in New Zealand. I would also like to recognise the significant role that the Law Commission played in the development of the Parliamentary Council Office and its report on the Review of Statutes Drafting and Compilation Act 1920, was the act that established the Parliamentary Council Office. And this work is reflected in our current Act, the Legislation Act 2012. Our officers continue to meet regularly to discuss matters of law reform and the Law Commission's programme of work. Today I have been asked to speak about law reform and accessibility. As we all know, access to the law is fundamental to the effective operation of the rule of law. In a democracy, the people governed by the law must have access to the rules by which they are governed. The importance of providing access to New Zealand laws is acknowledged in Parliamentary Council Office's mission statement, and that is to provide impartial, high-quality legislative drafting services and advice, and to enable free and easy access to the laws of New Zealand. Although not expressly provided for in legislation, Parliamentary Council Office has always exercised a stewardship or guardianship role in relation to New Zealand's legislation. It has done this by ensuring laws are legally effective, clear and consistent with other legislation, the general law and international law, and by ensuring that legislation is accessible to the public in both printed and electronic forms. Parliamentary Council Office is not alone, however, in having a stewardship responsibility. Section 51D of the Law Commission Act 1985 provides that one of the principal functions of the Law Commission is to advise the Minister on ways in which the law of New Zealand can be made as understandable and as accessible as is practicable. Public service chief executives also have obligations relating to legislative stewardship. Section 32 of the State Sector Act expressly states that one of the Chief Executive's responsibilities is a stewardship of the legislation administered by their departments. This includes, among other matters, ensuring that legislation is fit for purpose, for current and future needs, and being aware of the state of its legislation and using reasonable opportunities to improve legislation. Now, what is meant by stewardship? It has been defined as a proactive duty of care of and planning in the medium to long-term interests for an asset or resource on behalf of another group. For the Parliamentary Council Office, the asset or resource is the legislation of New Zealand. While agency chief executives are responsible for the stewardship of the legislation they administer, the Parliamentary Council Office takes a whole of statute perspective, ensuring that legislation is legally effective, well designed and accessible to all current and future users. Thus, the responsibilities of the Chief Executive and the Parliamentary Council Office in relation to legislation are separate but complementary. As I have just mentioned, part of the Parliamentary Council Office's stewardship role is providing and ensuring access to legislation now and in the future. Given Parliamentary Council's role in drafting and publishing legislation, my focus on accessibility is with legislation. The Solicitor-General will address accessibility to other New Zealand law, such as the common law. I would first like to define what we mean by access. Accessibility means ensuring that legislation is drafted as clearly as possible, is readable, and is presented and structured in a way that facilitates understanding. We need to ensure that it is in the form that users wish to access it, and users can access the complete collection of legislation. Thirdly, it's necessary that users be able to access legislation with ease, and within it can find the legislation they need. In summary, legislation must be understandable, available, and navigable. Now, how is Parliamentary Council Office currently seeking to improve access to legislation? This has been done in a number of ways. Under the Legislation Act 2012, we have a statutory responsibility to undertake a program of revision to make statute law more accessible, readable, and easier to understand. The Parliamentary Council Office has also launched a major project, which we're all very excited about, the Access to Subordinate Instruments Project. Some of you may have heard about it and been briefed on it. The object of this project is to improve access to legislation by publishing all subordinate instruments on the New Zealand legislation website. Note that this project is still subject to Cabinet approval, and we're taking a Cabinet paper up this month. We also have a variety of little housekeeping tools to keep legislation looking nice, clean and tidy. First, I would just like to say something about the revision programme. This is an important new tool for reforming the statute book, and it's new. It almost goes without saying that over time legislation can become inaccessible or ineffective. For example, it may use archaic language, include spent provisions, or refer to obsolete concepts. It may lose coherence through frequent amendment or otherwise fail to use current drafting style and format. These problems impose clear costs on the users of legislation. Users are less likely to understand how the law applies to them, or they may need to obtain expensive legal advice to work their way through the legislative maze. In some cases, the law just doesn't work how it should. The Legislation Act in 2012 introduced a new system for systematically revising New Zealand statute law. The purpose of the revision is to reenact the law in one or more acts in an up-to-date and accessible form. Revision is not intended to change the effect of the law, apart from some minor amendments for the sake of clarification and to matters such as changes to monetary amounts. And I'll come back to that further in a moment. The current revision system finds its origins in the Law Commission report Presentation of New Zealand Statute Law. In that law, it was noted, and I quote, "We think it is high time that there was a program of systematic revision of the acts in our statute book to get them into a more coherent state. This was last done in 1908. Today we have more statutes, there are over 1,100 of them, and they are in a more disorderly state than they were in 1908. But if the work could be done 100 years ago, without the aid of computers, or indeed any modern technology, it can be done now. If it is not, the present state of our statute book will get progressively worse." And the Law Commission also noted that the whole point is that revision does not change the substance of the law, only its presentation. It is about access to the law and about understanding it. Now, how does the revision work under the Legislation Act? In 2012, the Act required the Attorney-General to prepare a three-yearly revision program for each new parliament. I'll just briefly explain the process for the current program. This began in 2003 and commenced with an internal consultation process at the Parliamentary Council Office. We looked for suitable statutes for the first program. These were selected on the basis that they, one, were updated in language and style, outdated in language and style, and may have been heavily amended or repealed in part. They contained related areas of law that could be consolidated with other statutes into one statute. they were in frequent use or affected a significant sector of the public. They were unlikely to propose for amendment during the revision process, that is, they weren't on the government's legislation programme, and they were not about to be reviewed by the Law Commission. And another criteria that would be more easily accessible to people if the acts were revised. The Parliamentary Council Office provided this provisional list to the Attorney General before consulting departments. When consulting with departments, the office advised them of the resource implications of a revision, and these are not insignificant. A provisional programme was then prepared and forwarded to the Attorney General for approval to seek public submissions. During the consultation process, the judicial heads of bench, the universities, the New Zealand Law Society and the Auckland District Law Society were invited to comment. The Parliamentary Council Office also notified departmental chief executives about the consultation. The current programme was approved by the government and presented by the Attorney General to the Parliament after the election in December 2014. It then is incumbent on the Chief Parliamentary Counsel and the Office to prepare revision bills in accordance with that programme. I won't go through everything that a revision bill may do, but just to sum up, these are in the 2012 Act. They can omit redundant and spent provisions. They can update concepts and remove inconsistencies. They also take into account the Interpretation Act. They correct minor errors, they can make minor amendments to clarify Parliament's intent or reconcile inconsistencies, and can make any necessary repeals, savings and transitionals. The bill also includes, as part of the explanatory note, a statement setting out in general terms the inconsistencies, anomalies, discrepancies and omissions that were identified in the course of the preparation of the bill and how they have been remedied. A revision bill then goes through a certification process before it is introduced. The certifiers may certify the bill if they are satisfied that the revision powers have been exercised appropriately and that the bill does not change the effect of the law, except for those minor amendments. The four certifiers are the President of the Law Commission, the Solicitor-General, a retired High Court judge and the Chief Parliamentary Counsel. Standing orders also confer certain procedural advantages on revision bills. For example, there is no debate on the first reading or the third reading, and there is generally no committee stage. This increases the likelihood that revision bills will be able to be passed in a timely manner. It also doesn't encroach on the limited amount of house time available for passing the government's legislation programme. It was noted by a former Chief Parliamentary Counsel, David Noble, that if this wasn't provided for, then it would take 400 years for us to revise the statute book going through normal processes. Bit different to 1908. A general approach to drafting a revision bill is to get a good understanding of the existing law from textbooks, case law, as a base. Then start with official versions of the legislation. We then apply modern plain language drafting techniques. There's many of these modern language, plain language techniques we have. A very obvious one is creating a good logical structure, breaking up long sentences. Breaking up long sections, including more headings, including devices to improve access and understanding, for example, example boxes, overview provisions, and trying to use a narrative style. Our approach to making minor amendments has been fairly conservative. The power to make these amendments is very tightly constrained. The amendments can only be made to clarify Parliament's intent or to reconcile inconsistencies. The power has been used, for example, to reconcile minor inconsistencies in the court powers found in various contract statutes. The power to make amendments cannot, however, be used to make any substantive reforms, and I'll speak about that more in a moment. The advantages and limitations of revision. Revision offers clear advantages in terms of improving the accessibility of the New Zealand statute book. Applying modern plain language techniques to older statutes in particular gives us a real opportunity to improve the understandability of the law. It is well known that legislation that is frequently amended will lose its coherence over time. Revision gives an opportunity to reorganise legislation of this sort in a more logical and coherent structure. However, does revision represent a missed opportunity? Sometimes an act that is being revised contains provisions that would benefit from substantive reform. The reform might be relatively non-controversial or of a technical nature. However, the power to make minor amendments is not broad enough to cover the matter. The first revision bill illustrates this point. Currently before select committees, the Contract and Commercial Law Bill. This revises 11 acts, including the Contractual Remedies Act and the Sale of Goods Act. In a 1993 Law Commission report on the contract statutes, the Commission identified a significant issue concerning the relationship between these two acts. The Commission recommended that the Sale of Goods Act should be amended to enable the cancellation of a contract for the sale of goods to be governed by the provisions of the Contractual Remedies Act. The Commission believed that this would remove unnecessary fragmentation of the law. It would remove arbitrary or unjustified differences depending on which legislation happened to apply to the particular case. This proposal may and does have merit and is relatively technical in character. However, the proposal would involve amendments that are more than minor to clarify Parliament's intent or to reconcile inconsistencies. It was therefore considered to be outside the scope of a revision bill. Some may argue that a revision bill represents a missed opportunity because it can't make technical reforms of this sort. I would argue, however, that a revision bill provides a good platform for future reform. The bill puts the current law into a modern style that more readily allows for substantive reforms to be integrated. In addition, in the process of preparing a revision bill, the Parliamentary Council Office and officials can identify areas that would benefit from reform. These can be documented with a view to being included in a future reform package. Now, some people have identified inadvertent changes to the law as being a risk of revision. This risk has been minimised as far as possible by various safeguards surrounding the process. The safeguards include internal Parliamentary Council quality control, careful checking by the administrating department, a pre-introduction public consultation process, the certification process, and a full select committee process. These safeguards are supported by the interpretation rule in Section 35 of the Legislation Act. That section provides that a revision act is not intended to change the effect of the law. The courts are likely to use this rule to help resolve any interpretation issues. Any risk of revision needs to be balanced against the risk of doing nothing. I would argue that leaving legislation in an outdated form represents a significantly higher risk. I'd just like to mention the role of departments. This is a team effort, a revision bill. While the Parliamentary Council Office holds the pen, we can't do it alone. The administering department has a vital role to play in terms of answering questions about the Act to be revised, researching issues relating to the correct interpretation of the current law, and checking that the revision powers have been exercised correctly. We understand that putting this time and effort into a revision bill can be difficult when the department has many competing substantive reform priorities. Current legislative priorities need to be balanced, however, against the need to keep the existing stock of legislation in a decent state. This is consistent with one of the principal responsibilities of departmental chief executives that I mentioned in Section 32 of the State Sector Act. I would now like to turn briefly to discuss the Access to Subordinate Instruments project, which I referred to earlier. As most of you are no doubt aware, subordinate instruments are made under the delegated lawmaking authority of Parliament. They are called by a variety of names, regulations, orders, notices, rules, and so on. They are currently referred to as legislative instruments. These instruments cover all facets of New Zealand business and other interactions from food standards and transport rules to financial reporting standards and national policy statements for environmental matters. Those that are drafted by the Parliamentary Council Office are published in full on the New Zealand Legislation website. However, those that are drafted by agencies other than the Parliamentary Council Office are not. These instruments may be published or notified in the Gazette. Some are published in newspapers or on various agencies' websites. Some are not published at all. In summary, there is no single place where businesses and citizens can access this legislation. This project has been set up to address this problem. The objective of the project is to improve access to legislation by having a single, comprehensive, official public source of legislation for all New Zealanders.
The problem with accessing subordinate instruments is highlighted by the fact that no one knows how many subordinate instruments there are, how many agencies are empowered to make them, and where all of the instruments can be found. Before the project began, the Regulations Review Committee knew of 47 agencies that were empowered to make subordinate instruments. So far, the project has identified over 100 such agencies, and this excludes local authorities. The problems created by the current inability to find all of New Zealand's legislation have been documented in, amongst other things, the government inquiry into the whey protein concentrate contamination incident, December 2013, the report of the New Zealand Productivity Commission's inquiry into regulatory institutions and practices, June 2014, the Regulations Review Committee's inquiry into the oversight of disallowable instruments that are not legislative instruments in July 2014. The government inquiry into the whey protein concentrate contamination incident was tasked with reviewing New Zealand's dairy food safety regulatory system. The inquiry found that the tertiary layer of dairy industry regulation includes numerous instruments of different types and runs to about 12,000 pages, taking up more than 3 metres of shelf space. Submitters noted this layer is difficult to navigate, inaccessible, and a bit of a nightmare. The burden of navigating the tertiary layer is particularly felt by small to medium-sized businesses. An experienced legal researcher contracted by the project team to find subordinate instruments stated, "Overall, I have to confess that in carrying out the searches, I often felt that I had stepped into a quagmire. It is very difficult to see how many people could begin to inform themselves about the legal frameworks that may apply to them. It is not possible to know whether an instrument exists unless one can find it. The lack of a known, accessible and easy to navigate system through which these instruments can be found is quite remarkable and quite concerning." The project has three main components. First, legal and procedural changes to modernise and simplify the statute book and the legislative in-house processes. Second, the development of an authoring and publication system for drafting, lodging and publishing subordinate instruments. And thirdly, collecting subordinate instruments and modifying Parliamentary Council Office's publishing and the New Zealand website to provide access to them. At this stage, the following are not within the scope of the project. Administrative documents, which are documents made under empowering provisions and enactments but do not have legislative effect, and documents made by local authorities. The Access to Subordinate Instrument project is progressing well, and the first Cabinet paper for the project will be submitted to Cabinet for approval shortly. Approval will be sought for the project in the drafting of a bill and a lodgement, and for developing IT solutions to give effect to the project. For more information about the project, please refer to the PCO website. Information on the website includes a one-page overview and an outline of the project, as well as the design sheets for the three components I have referred to. Moving on, I'd just like to address some housekeeping matters. George Tanner, former Chief Parliamentary Counsel and Law Commission, noted some years ago that we paint our houses and service our cars, but we don't look after our laws in the same way. As part of Parliamentary Council Office's role is to ensure legislation is accessible, we need to proactively maintain the legislation on the New Zealand legislation website. We need to regularly review legislation across the database and update it, fix any clerical and drafting issues, and remove obsolete enactments. In this way, we can tidy up and declutter the legislation database. I like to think of this as being good housekeepers of legislation. I've already discussed in some detail one of these housekeeping tools, the revision program. There are, however, other tools we can use. I'd first like to discuss the reprint powers. These permits minor editorial changes under Section 25(1) of the Legislation Act. This power can be used to modernise legislation and to make it consistent with current drafting expression, style and format. Amendments can be made to gender-specific language, correct punctuation and conjunctives, disjunctives, grammar and spelling, sequential numbering, cross-referencing, alphabetical ordering, errors arising out of an amendment, changes to ensure consistency of expression for dates, times, etc., and consistency of drafting practice. Changes to format can also be made under Section 26. This power was used during the officialisation process to enable older style legislation to be updated into the current format. Another power to keep legislation tidy relates to renumbering. Under Section 25.2, the Governor-General may, by order in Council, authorise the Chief Parliamentary Counsel to reprint legislation to number or renumber provisions as set out in the order and to update cross-references. To date, this power has not been exercised. Another opportunity for housekeeping arises through the Annual Statutes Amendment Bill. This bill, led by the Ministry of Justice, can make policy changes to acts that are short, technical and non-controversial. However, all amendments contained in a statutes amendment bill must have cross-party support. Failure to get the support means that either the clause is not included in the introduced bill or is struck out at committee stage. There is also currently a statutes repeal bill in the House repealing redundant legislation. We are also working with departments on policy rewrite bills, such as the Social Security rewrite bill. Rewrite bills are not suitable for the revision program as they include policy changes as well. We also have under consideration a statute laws revision and repeals bill. However, despite all these powers, some issues will be too significant to be fixed under the reprint powers. Identified legislation that is not on a revision program and unable to be fixed under the wider revision powers, or not significant enough for a statutes amendment bill, or in legislation that is not being amended or being written. To fill this gap, the Parliamentary Council Office is working on a proposal for a statute laws revision and repeal bill based on an Australian model to provide another useful housekeeping tool. The intention is that the government would introduce a bill approximately every 2 or 3 years. A statute laws revision and repeal bill would improve access to legislation by enhancing clarity and promoting consistency across the e-statute book, revise legislation by making amendments that are short, technical and non-controversial, have limited policy implications, for example, only a minor effect on the law, and of a type that would be permitted under revision powers. A statutes laws revision or repeal bill would also repeal obsolete provisions, but would exclude amendments that can be fixed under the editorial changes power or need to be fixed in an annual statutes amendment bill or in principal replacement or amendment legislation. So where to in the future? Although legislation has been available online since 2008, New Zealand legislation truly entered the digital age with the officialisation of legislation online in January 2014. On that date, we moved from a hard copy paper-based world into a digital world. The statute book, in effect, became the statute e-book. This new digital era brings new opportunities in relation to the tools that are used to publish and arrange the law. It provides the Parliamentary Council Office the opportunity to rethink the way legislation is both drafted and presented. There is evidence that digitalisation has led to legislation enduring a larger readership than in the past. The web has made it possible for people to find sources of law more easily. Before online officialisation, it would not have been possible to even contemplate providing access to all subordinate instruments, which is the object of the Access to Subordinate Instruments project. As technology gathers speed, how do we ensure legislation remains fit for purpose and responsive to these changes? At the Parliamentary Council Office, while busy doing our day-to-day job of drafting and publishing the Government of the Day's legislation, we are focused on the future and its possibilities. We will continue to look for opportunities to improve access to New Zealand's laws, and I say that deliberately rather than just referring to legislation. We're very aware that legislation is only one type of law. Opportunity now exists to consider hyperlinking with case law and other explanatory material relating to legislation. I would like to leave you with a quote from David Bowie. I saw this quote on a sandwich board down Lambton Quay, and I like to keep it in mind. The future belongs to those who can hear it coming. Thank you.
She did set the scene very nicely for us, making that key fundamental initial point about the role of accessibility in the operation of the rule of law. And I feel confident that Una is going to take that point and move on with it. So with great pleasure, I invite our Solicitor-General, Una Jagose, to speak to us. Thank you.
Aku rangatira, tēnā taku mihi atu ki a koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Perhaps it will be at the 31st symposium address where I get to say, take the blue pill, I'll ring a bell in half an hour, take the other pill, and I'll be done. But for today, I have half an hour to address you. In our democracy committed to the rule of law, accessibility is obviously critical. And I know this isn't a new concept, but I think we need to keep thinking about it and giving it regular consideration so we don't risk losing it by constantly nibbling around its edges. And in a sort of modern parlour game approach to quotes about accessibility to the law, there are some well-known expressions: to no one will we sell, to no one deny and delay right or justice. There cannot be a rule of law without access, otherwise the rule of law is replaced by the rule of men and women who decide who shall and who shall not have access to justice. And the law must be accessible and, so far as possible, clear, intelligible and predictable. So accessibility to the law is at least twofold, I think. The right to know the content of the laws that govern us, and in a democracy that governs according to the rule of law, the laws that govern all of us, but also the right for citizens to bring disputes before an impartial body for resolution. And the challenge isn't simply to ensure that the citizens have access to the courts through which they can access the legal system. Even without getting into the complexities of how justice systems can be made inaccessible through the doorway costs of filing fees, the costs of lawyers, the closed club that lets only the trained few into the hallowed halls, I say the rule of law requires something much more basic in our quest for accessibility to the laws of New Zealand. And it is this: for a country to truly claim commitment to the rule of law, it must also be committed to the system that governs us. The checks and balances in place and the constitutional framework that we operate under being open, clear and understood. Because without a good understanding of the frameworks by which the branches of government operate, the independence and the dependencies between them, the citizenry can develop a cynicism about our democratic institutions, about the government, about courts, about the legislature, that tells against accessibility. On my assessment, we're not doing very well in New Zealand. And when I read the news, and although I know I shouldn't, now that you can read the comments that people want to make about the news, when you read those comments, I see a severe lack of understanding of the most basic of propositions about how we are governed and how the law works. And I see considerable room for improvement in the understanding of the basics of our constitutional frameworks in my day-to-day work in the public service. But does it matter? And does anyone care? I say it does matter. Because for accessibility to the law to be meaningful, people need to trust the institutions that deliver the law and that operate according to law, whether it's governments making decisions, agencies enforcing the law, prosecutions and judicial officers in courts and tribunals dispensing justice around the country. Unless people trust our institutions and don't cynically view them as corrupt or meaningless architecture of a powerful state, accessibility will lack real meaning. Add to that lack of general knowledge and, potentially, lack of interest about our constitutional underpinnings the fact that they tend to be under convention rather than by clear and enforceable rule. Conventions are fragile. The rule of law cannot be left to vagaries and be fragile, and it must be strengthened and must be meaningful. So I see a key role for me in my office in this quest for developing a better understanding of or strengthening the credibility of the rule of law, so as to make the laws of New Zealand as understandable and as accessible as practicable. And there are many signs that there is a way to go yet. Recently, the Solicitor-General was in the news a little bit in relation to a case that was before our courts. And there was some conversation on social media about the case. And somebody asked, who or what is the Solicitor-General? The responses included the Attorney-General's dog's body in quite an official and dignified sense, which I thought was quite good. Another person said, some government dude. Both a little bit true in part, but I think they lack the essence of, you know, is it naive for me to want to get us to a position where that same question is responded to on social media with this idea that the Solicitor General is one of many parts of our constitutional framework that ensures government governs according to law. So that got me to thinking, is the traditional no comment default position from law officers acceptable anymore? I know there are a few things in tension, even when I ask this question, let alone deal with it. We need to balance the need to avoid commenting on matters before the court. It's the executive and not public servants who are responsible for promoting and defending government policy. There's legal professional privilege at play sometimes in that question, but there is a real public interest in strengthening the understanding of the rule of law that also has to be put into that balance. I feel it's no longer possible to leave the public understanding about the systems of the three branches of government to chance, or to public commentators who don't necessarily distinguish between content and process. The Solicitor-General can play an important role in this public understanding of our systems, and others can too. And of course, like I think Her Excellency, I give a nod to Sir Geoffrey and Dr. Butler for their ambitious roadshow and constitutional conversation that they want to have with the people. Good luck to you. If we step back and look at the whole system, there are plenty of players in this ambition. There is a role for schools, for civics, constitutional law and basic legal information to be essential curricular items. People will be able to make better and informed decisions about those things that matter: children's upbringing, relationship property, wills, tenancy disputes, if they know what the law is. But importantly, they'll be able to see for themselves the value and access to justice, what the law is, how it works, and how to enforce it. The United Kingdom's curriculum has compulsory civics and other legal content, and what is taught there is not just the basics for individuals to be able to function in society, but they also must learn about the role of citizens in Parliament. They learn about how citizens can hold those in power to account. They learn about the different roles of the executive, legislature, judiciary, and a free press. Electoral systems, different electoral systems, other forms of government, human rights and international law, and how law can help society deal with complex problems. And despite having some good resources here, the New Zealand's Ministry of Justice website has resources for teachers. Community law centres, their rights education project, and community law manual, all these things are valuable resources. But we need to do better if we want New Zealanders as a society to be law and constitution literate. Because if we can move people to a point, if we can move society to a point where people do know about the frameworks and the laws, how they're affected, how they can hold government to account, and how they can hold others to account, people will start to demand access to justice, not just to the statute book, but to the content of the common law and the justice institutions. And if we can get that right at that sort of primary level, perhaps we reduce the pressure on formal institutions as being the last and only resort for dispute resolution. And Fiona has been addressing the ambition for the statute book to be accessible, plain languaged, and in one place and online. But if we only focus on the statute book and we forget the other bit of the laws of New Zealand, as referenced in the Law Commission Act, the common law, we risk a huge part of the laws of New Zealand still being the preserve of just a few. Courts plainly have a role in this ambition of making the common law accessible. The development of the common law through the courts risks falling behind its statutory counterpart if what the law is, and as it's developed and interpreted, remains mired in arcane specialty legal expression and dense legal text. So, of course, plain language for lawyers and for judges is starting to gain prevalence, but is one of the most powerful tools, I think, for achieving accessibility to the common law. And I accept that plain language lawyering and judging will take time and discipline, and there'll be a new twist on the old excuse, my apologies, these submissions are so long, Your Honours, I had no time to make them more concise. Because plain language is a discipline and a challenging one, especially in a technical area. But it is possible. I'll give you just one example from the Ontario Court of Justice last year, in a case about a defendant, Jesse Armitage. This was in the Gladue Court, which is a Canadian principle of sentencing which recognises that particular circumstances facing Aboriginal people in sentencing must be taken account of, and all reasonable alternatives to imprisonment must be considered. So the judge says, before I get to the decision, I like to make two short comments. First of all, I want to say something about the style of this decision. For those who have read some of my past judgments, the reader will notice a change. For Jesse Armitage, I have tried to say what I wanted to say in very plain language. I believe it's important for judges to do that in every decision. However, judges often do not do a good job of this. I would describe myself as one of the worst sinners. As lawyers first, then judges, we get used to using words that are long and complicated. This muddies the message we're trying to say. That message is very important when it comes to passing sentence on an offender. He goes on to say, all accused should have their voices heard. Judges struggle to make sure they do. And when judges write their decisions, they're writing for different readers, for different audiences. They write not only for the parties before them, they write to other readers of the law, for lawyers, other judges, the communities. And in this case, I'm writing for Jesse Armitage. Another point that the courts can assist in the advancement of accessibility, Her Honour Dame Ellen France referenced the fact that judges make and develop the law of New Zealand. Pretty ordinary concept in this room. As Sir Kenneth Keith said the other day in his address to the New Zealand Centre for Public Law, it was entitled My Life in the Law, he said just quite casually, I thought, judges move the law along. And of course, again, in that audience, nobody blinks an eye. But do people out in the world get that judges move the law along? I say, respectfully, it's also incumbent on courts to explain when they are moving the law along and to say that it's a legitimate part of the judicial function, although I accept that it has its limits. But recently, it was left to the Crown Party to explain in public why a decision which overturned some 15 years of appellate authority on determining how to count time for prison sentences, left to explain to the media what that meant. The past practice had been lawful, although it no longer was, in the delivery of the Supreme Court judgment. And the past practice had been consistent with appellate authority until that point. The judgment made no mention of this, and so in the media scrum that followed, there is really no place for the complexities of what happens when courts overrule other courts and an analysis of retrospective declaratory effective judgments and prospective overruling. These are not media sound bites, right? So there's no place in the media scrum for that discussion when their headlines say prison sentence is incorrect because corrections got the law wrong. The senior court's practice of press releases explaining the contents of judgments is an excellent innovation, and I do know, Your Honours, that that's not part of the common law. But it's really good for the public to get to understand what the judgment means and what it stands for. And so too, the Court of Appeal guideline judgments in criminal cases, even though those guideline judgments are focused on structured sentencing, they're a useful guide to the development of the law too, because we do see them sometimes represent a judicial response to legislative change or actually to changes or approaches of certain crimes or aspects of those crimes as society changes. One example is the Court of Appeal in Terawi revised the previous tariff case in Dutch, taking account of the increasing prevalence of cannabis cultivation and the development of hydroponic cultivation techniques, and upped the tariff guideline, despite the fact that Parliament hadn't changed the maximum penalty since 1975. So there we see those guideline judgments also being used to reflect society, perhaps to move the law along. Of course, technology will also allow for access to the developing common law in new ways too. One of the speakers earlier mentioned the statute book with hypertext links. How about judgments with hypertext links directly to the source material? Perhaps it's the other case law, perhaps it's the statute. It might also be to some of the extrinsic material that goes into the determination of what Parliament meant when it enacted a certain provision, a link to the Hansard debate, perhaps. There the reader can see the whole collection of what came to make the content of that law. But beyond empowering people in education and use of plain language, another and more literal accessibility barrier is, of course, court fees and the cost of engaging counsel. Others may comment on the adequacy of the current fee structure and legal aid regime. And so my point is just like, is that like squeezing a balloon, pressure on funding and increased costs to accessing the courts will cause the pressure to bulge somewhere else. In other parts of society, we see crowdsourcing has taken off. So could we, should we crowdsource access to justice, crowdfund it? Litigation funding, I know, isn't quite crowdsourcing and crowdfunding, but even litigation funding has been said by the Supreme Court recently to be not a general panacea to offset rising costs of litigation and resulting access to justice concerns. The court there noting that inequality of access to litigation funding might also mean there continues to be inequality of resources in litigation. But the combination of representative proceedings, as the High Court rules permit, along with litigation funding, does seem to be a potentially powerful tool against procedural and financial barriers to justice. And the courts are alive to the fact that when those two things come together, representative actions and litigation funding, a different dynamic might come into play in balancing the interests between plaintiffs and defendants. And the Court of Appeal has set out in Saunders and Houghton what the additional steps might be needed to make sure that in considering litigation funding in a representative action, the whole deal is examined, as that court said, as a stool supported by four legs, each essential to its stability, the representation aspect, the funding arrangement, any application for security for costs, and a merits appraisal, a provisional merits appraisal. Following the Law Commission's recommendation in 2001 in its subsidising litigation report, the Lawyers and Conveyances Act permits litigation to be conducted on a contingency fee arrangement, a fee for success, subject to certain exceptions and to rules that the Law Society has made. But back to crowdfunding. Will we see, I need $100,000 to sue my neighbour, or perhaps more popularly, I need $100,000 to sue the government, make a donation here? I don't see anything that stops that form of funding access to justice, so long as the litigant and the fundraiser remains under the control of the court and the rules of litigation, that she risks the costs of litigation if they exceed her budget, and that she doesn't attempt to assign her cause of action to an unrelated funder. I don't think we've seen it yet. I'm sure we will. The other bulge of pressure we see is the rise and rise of the unrepresented litigant. Where does the unrepresented litigant fit into the scheme of thinking about access to justice? Building off my earlier point, better educating people about their rights and getting better human-centred designed systems may encourage people to represent themselves if the mist around the content of the law is cleared somewhat for them. It certainly enhances access to justice to let people access non-litigation forms of dispute resolution, the Ombudsman, the Privacy Commissioner, disputes tribunals. We might add to that these days the rise and rise of self-help. I accept makes me sound like a dinosaur, but that sort of approach of public shaming of breach of legal entitlement. We need to know what the law is before we can do that. But that only takes us so far, because thinking about the barriers to the traditional courts, should they be lowered so that people can represent themselves more easily? And the prevalence of unrepresented litigants in the higher courts and in complex matters may appear that the lack of a lawyer is no barrier to accessibility to justice. Some system reform has been aimed at improving access by unrepresented litigants. And I have to say there is a prevalence of unrepresented litigants because that's how it appears, but there's very little organised research on this point. It is a point that Dr. Toy-Cronin might make today, I think, because she does make it in her 2015 PhD thesis. Justice Wynne Kelman made this observation in her address, her Ethel Benjamin address in 2014, Access to Justice, Who Needs Lawyers? She also had to only observe that there are more and more people coming before the courts unrepresented. And she noted the little trend information that she had, but she did give some brief data. In 2014, 40% of the applications for leave to appeal to the Supreme Court were made by applicants in person. And 21 out of the 23 applications for recall of Supreme Court judgments were similarly made by applicants in person. In the Court of Appeal, 25% of civil files had an unrepresented litigant. Is it a sign that we're winning in accessibility to justice? And with respect to Her Honour, I agree that the benefits there may be illusory. With unrepresented litigants increasing the cost, the length, and at times the complexity of litigation, altering the obligations on some opposing litigants, the Crown, I think, in particular, has certain obligations, particularly in criminal matters, if they're dealing with unrepresented litigants, and changing the adjudicative task that the court has always had. In such cases, will impose a much greater burden on the court, and sometimes on counsel, to ensure there aren't unwitting injustices done to such litigants through their own endeavours to bring their case, and the attendant frustrations that can cause the system overall. But we do see some positive moves too, pro bono work being done by private lawyers and my own observation of the rise in agencies like the Human Rights Commission taking a more active intervention approach in litigation in order to put a wider human rights-centred view are ways that the profession can make a meaningful contribution to improving access to justice. And of course, self-represented litigants may, but of course not always, present a different challenge, that of preventing their access to the courts if they are bringing vexatious proceedings. And here again we see a delicate balance, access to justice, the rule of law and the efficient use of resources. Following the Law Commission's recommended graduated civil orders regime, along with the ability for the courts to make particularised orders and conditions on litigants, the current sort of all or nothing approach of the Judicature Act, which currently only permits the attorney, or in practice the Solicitor General, to bring such an application, and the replacement of that with this new civil orders regime, which has recently been enacted in the Judicature Modernisation Bill, I think will make an improvement on the perhaps limiting access to justice for a point or for a part or temporarily or on conditions, just as a much more nuanced tool that might be available. So we have to keep thinking about system reform too, to make sure as soon as practicable the laws of New Zealand are accessible. And we often think about process as the bastion of fair outcomes, but can process actually be a barrier to accessibility? Judge Harvey noted this in his recently published paper on online court approaches. He said one of the obstacles to access to justice is that of process. Our rules are premised on reaching a court hearing. So all of the rules in common law jurisdictions represent a collection of milestones with the destination being a case in court. So what might system reform look like if the destination was not presentation of your case in court, but some other resolution option? England and Wales is currently consulting over what seems like some significant reform of its processes using technology and human-centred design to reduce the cost and prevalence of litigation in what has been said to be traditional bleak house-like arrangements. In a joint statement made in September, the Lord Chancellor, the Lord Chief Justice of England and Wales and the Senior President of the Tribunals outlined their joint vision for the future of Her Majesty's courts and tribunals. They said the revolution in technology will characterise tomorrow's justice system. We will provide online access by developing a single online system for starting and managing cases across the criminal, civil, family and tribunal jurisdictions. There will be a new, highly simplified procedural code. An online form will guide people through their application. This new approach will be designed to promote more conciliatory approaches to dispute resolution, to be understandable to non-lawyers, helping ordinary people resolve their issues in a low-key way without needing expensive legal representation to help them understand what to do. And I've been reading a book called The Future of the Professions. It's written by Professor Richard Susskind and his son, co-written with his son Daniel. And Richard Susskind has long been writing and thinking about the legal profession and our future. And this looks at the impact of technology on a range of professions. I must say my attention was rather more snagged by the idea that you in fact can, it's not even a future idea, download a confessional app that has drop-down menus of sins and acts of contrition that you are able to help yourself with. I believe the Catholic Church has issued an instruction to say that that's not actually confession. Those apps just help you prepare for the actual confession. But anyway, for the purpose of this talk, the Susskind's future sees us completing dispute resolution in binding online fora, perhaps ending the idea that drives some litigants of getting their day in court, but delivering effective justice nevertheless, reliable interactive legal consultation and diagnostic tools, online communities contributing free source way, contributing their experience, right through to artificial intelligence systems that will identify your fact scenario, identify and apply the relevant law and deliver the outcome which will be binding. So should we kill all the lawyers yet? Can technology take us further than people will in our quest for accessible justice? My pick, and perhaps it's understandable that I would say so, is that we will still need lawyers and judges, perhaps less than we have now, and perhaps learning to deliver our valuable services in quite a different way. The New Zealand market already has Legal Beagle, complete online dispute resolution, Evolution Lawyers, and Online Lawyers New Zealand, revolutionising how we resolve legal disputes outside the courts. Technological advances and new generations of technically savvy citizens, along with the imperative to do more for less, will force us as a profession and the institutions of government to innovate, to provide better, more efficient access to justice, even thinking about mainstream, not just alternative dispute resolution. Just last month, the Institute of Directors and Chapman Tripp have produced a white paper in which they explore the potential impact of artificial intelligence on New Zealand's social and economic infrastructure and our labour market, including, of course, the legal profession. They call on the government to establish joint private and public sector collaboration to ensure New Zealand is set to harness the benefits and avoid the risks of the inevitable upsurge of artificial intelligence in our lives. Perhaps that's something for the Law Commission to attend to. I saw an example too of at Stanford Law School, they have a project they call Human-Centered Design, where they're using technology and law to develop a new generation of legal services. It's at legaltechdesign.com if you want to know. Their projects this year include open source platforms to create and publish guides to legal process that have visual triage processes that people can use to work out what to do and where to go. And they're also trialling instant messaging and texting to help people through the court process, not just to remind them to go, but also to tell them about how to behave, what to wear, what to say, who will you see when you get there, so that they can help themselves through and improve people's sense of procedural justice as they go through those systems. One of the challenges for the public service, tending to be at the forefront of system design, is to design systems with New Zealanders, the users, in mind. New Zealand's better public services requires all of us to improve in addressing complex, long-term issues that affect New Zealanders. And the key to delivering on that now familiar adage of doing more with less lies in productivity, innovation, and increased agility to provide services. Agencies need to change, to develop new business models, to work more closely with others, and to harness new technologies in order to meet emerging challenges. So if we think about better public services in concert with the rule of law, we can see the common thread is people. We must design policy, processes, systems for accessibility of the law with people for whom justice is delivered and the rule of law, without which we are nothing, firmly at the centre of our design. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa.
Thank you, Una, for a thought-provoking address that took us through the importance and principle of all of us, all New Zealand citizens, being literate in a legal and constitutional sense, or law and constitutional sense, identified some of the pressure points that we face in achieving this goal, and concluding with the challenge, I guess, to all of us about how we can achieve that. So many thanks. We now have three panellists whose instructions were not to critique the presentations by Fiona or Una, but really to take advantage of their own backgrounds, their own interests, and take us to a different point in the discussion of accessibility in the context of law reform. And I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Arie Rosen, lecturer in jurisprudence at the Auckland Law School, to come and address us. Thank you.
So thank you very much, and I'm deeply honored to be here, to be invited here, and it's a real pleasure for philosophers to speak to the profession, to the practical part of it. So the topic of this session is accessibility, and as mentioned by the Solicitor General, accessibility of the law is an important part of the rule of law tradition, and more particularly part of a project that was pioneered by Jeremy Bentham some 200, 250 years ago of the clarification and simplification of the law. But accessibility, both in the tradition of the rule of law and in the Benthamite tradition, has another connotation which is also relevant to the work of the Law Commission, and that is the accessibility of the Law Commission itself, which is the subject of my remarks. Much of our legal and political tradition is committed to the notion that political and legal decisions should be made in a way that is accessible to those affected by them. Concerns of accessibility are usually balanced and complemented by concerns regarding independence and the risk of capture, and I was happy to hear the President of the Law Commission mentioning independence, which is also mentioned in the Law Commission Act. Because we never want to make decision makers too accessible, too accountable, too responsive to the concerns of those affected by their decisions, because that might be the path to corruption and other pathologies of bad decision making. These concerns about accessibility and independence are evident in the procedures of our long-standing institutions. In courtrooms, accessibility and participation take a particular form. The balance between accessibility and independence is governed by rules concerning separation of powers, evidence, standing, and rules of natural justice. In democratic legislation, accessibility features both in the process inside the legislature, by means of submissions to select committee, for example, and outside the legislature through election processes, and they are balanced by rules regarding lobbying, elections, and campaigning. Well, this is appropriate. Rules regarding lobbying, elections, and campaigning that ensure the relative independence of elected representatives. Law commissions and similar bodies are relatively a new type of institution in the common law world, with new practices surrounding accessibility and independence which deserve attention. Indeed, in recent years, there has been an increasing scholarly interest in bodies like the New Zealand Law Commission, the English Law Commission, the Scottish Law Commission, codification committees in common law jurisdictions, and particularly in the United States, what is sometimes called private legislatures, like the American Law Institute that is responsible for the Restatement Project, or the National Conference of Commissioners that is responsible for the Uniform Commercial Code. These institutions share certain common features, but are not by no means the same, so I want to preface what I am about to say by emphasizing the general nature of my comments. That these comments are not intended to evaluate or comment on the Law Commission and its practices, but more providing general guidelines for thinking about this important institution, its role, and its challenges. And I want to limit myself to making two comments, which I take to be the most fundamental in this regard. The first comment concerns the decision-making capacity of law commissions. In the design and in the formal way we think about them, law commissions are similar, and similar bodies are assigned an advisory or preparatory role. One of the reasons for the growing scholarly interest in these bodies is the recognition that these institutions actually function as decision makers, at least sometimes. This is so for two reasons. First, research finds that reports, recommendations, and draft bills are being used as an authoritative point of reference by courts and administrative agencies, even when they are not implemented by legislation. This means that there are various ways in which decisions of law commissions impact the law in a manner that is unmediated by Parliament. Second, and more importantly in my mind, some draft bills and recommendations by law commissions do not receive the same sort of democratic scrutiny as they make their way through the legislative process. A large part of the portfolio of law commissions, although not all of it, at least not in this jurisdiction, includes topics that are of little interest to politicians and their constituencies. So it might come as a shock to people in this room that very few people care about the rights of third parties to a contract, or the doctrine of misrepresentation, or the impact of a particular provision regarding the management of trusts. It's not to say these are not important issues of economic and moral significance, nor is it to say that politicians should not care about these matters. It's just to recognize the fact that these topics are not experienced as politically significant and are not treated as such by politicians. In the academic jargon, these are referred to as issues of low political salience. As part of my own research, I looked at the legislation of contract law statutes in England and Wales based on the work of the English Law Commission. I found that draft bills were hardly debated in Parliament, and when they were debated, the legislative process had particular characteristics that afforded an attenuated level of scrutiny to these bills. So my first observation, based on this burgeoning scholarship, is that law commissions should be recognized as decision-making bodies whose significance goes beyond their formal advisory role. My second comment builds on this insight and draws some conclusions regarding accessibility and independence. Most law commissions and similar bodies observe very liberal modes of consultation and in this regard afford a high level of access. But of course, formal equality in access is different from equal impact on the working of institutions. The danger here, and this danger has been mapped particularly in the American context, is the unbalanced impact of corporations and other strong, well-funded interest groups. The literature shows that benign consultation can turn into relations of dependence and capture, particularly when certain circumstances arise. So when strong interests are involved, when strong interest groups are present just on one side of the issue, when the issues concerned are of a technical nature, of low political salience, and when the resources available to law commissions and similar bodies to conduct independent research are limited. In these situations, the research and data prepared by interested third parties might be given undue weight by law commissions in the absence of an alternative source of reliable research. So my second observation is that we should worry about the balance between access and independence in the working of the Law Commission. As these are only general comments, it would be inappropriate to draw from them any concrete recommendations for New Zealand. But if I can leave this distinguished forum with three practical, well, semi-practical thoughts, they would be the following. First, that the Law Commission is an important decision-making body which should be treated and thought of as such. Second, that the regulation of access and consultation should bear in mind the challenges posed by consultation with strong, well-funded interest groups. And third, that the independent research of the Law Commission should be properly funded in a way that would help it avoid dependence on consultation with interested third parties. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arie. Some insightful comments on the Law Commission, some points we'd very much like to talk about more. For example, funding, always good. Can I now invite Fazleen Ismail to address us? Fazleen is currently the General Manager of the Law Reform and Sections New Zealand Law Society, but she brings quite a different background to bear in terms of her consideration of issues of accessibility, and I would like to invite her to talk to us about that now. Thank you.
Thank you, Helen, and thank you to the Law Commission for inviting me to speak here today. I'm feeling a bit like the odd one out, I have to say, because I'm not a lawyer. I'm actually an economist by background. Now, economics can be defined in many ways, and some of those definitions are not at all flattering. In particular, I recall one, the 19th century Scottish writer Thomas Carlyle called it the dismal science. But essentially, economics is about how society uses its scarce resources, and one of the central tenets of economics is that people will respond to incentives. Governments have increasingly used economics to understand how people might respond to changes in law, and also to identify whether there might be some wider consequences, perhaps unintended. And laws, without a doubt, affect how an economy performs. It was actually Dr. Alan Greenspan, former US chairman of the US Federal Reserve, who said in a speech that he gave about markets and the judiciary, "The rule of law is critical to economic growth." In particular, he cited the protection of rights of the individual and property rights, and he went on to note that since the early 18th century, the force of the rule of law has fostered standards of living that have risen by 20 times in the parts of the world that have embraced competitive markets. A couple of years ago, the Australian Productivity Commission did a report on the civil justice system, and they noted, of course, the importance of a well-functioning civil justice system to protect individuals and businesses from infringements of their rights. But they also noted that the ability of individuals to enforce their rights can have profound impacts on a person's well-being and quality of life. And a well-functioning civil justice system, it serves more than just private interests. It promotes social order, it communicates and reinforces civic values and norms, and it gives people the confidence to enter into business relationships, to enter into contracts, and to invest. And all of this contributes to economic performance. So economics and law, I think, are closely linked. But what does an economist have to contribute to a discussion about accessibility of law reform and of law? Before I give you some reflections on that, I'd like to tell you a story. I'll only get the loan if it's guaranteed. It's just your name, dear. You won't have to pay anything. Just your name and sign for it. That was the explanation that a mother, desperate for a $28,000 consolidated loan, gave to her daughter. The daughter, understandably wanting to support her mother, agreed to be the guarantor. But when she went to the lender's office to sign the documents, the lender only asked if she was willing to guarantee the loan. They assumed she knew what it meant, but she didn't. And it was only when her mother defaulted on the loan because she couldn't repay it and the daughter had to start making the repayments that she realized the implications of being a guarantor. But unfortunately, by this stage, the loan had ballooned to $53,000. This is an unfortunate, but unfortunately common scenario in New Zealand. Why is it relevant? I'm going to come to that shortly. Across the developed world, including in New Zealand, regulatory impact analysis has been used by governments to understand the implications of developing new laws or amending existing ones. Now, there are a lot of tools used in regulatory impact analysis, for example, cost-benefit analysis, and many assumptions are made in doing these analyses, and there are many criticisms of these assumptions. One is that traditional neoclassical economics assumptions of people being completely rational and acting in their self-interests don't bear out in reality in many situations. In response to this, in recent years, we've seen the emergence of behavioural economics. Now, behavioural economics stresses the importance of understanding how personal limitations, bias, or heuristics can affect how people actually make decisions. So the story I told you earlier is relevant because prior to June last year, consumer credit law in New Zealand relied on disclosure to inform people so that they could protect themselves. But in reality, people were making poor choices, whether it was due to a lack of financial capability or bias, for example, being overly optimistic in their ability to repay debt. So economics, I think, can assist in the development of the law, but assumptions have to be grounded in reality. Lawyers know the law, but they cannot, on their own, I would say, understand the full implications of proposed rules or how it might achieve policy objectives, particularly when it comes to behaviour. And that is where economics can help. But lawyers, even with the assistance of economists, don't know everything. And that is why public consultation is vitally important. Good law reform depends on an ecosystem. It doesn't happen in a vacuum. Public consultation at its heart is about asking those who are affected or those who have knowledge and expertise in an area for their views, their perspectives, their ideas. It's vital to understanding whether proposed new legislation achieves its objectives, whether it may have some unintended consequences, what its interactions may be with other laws. Now, I know that many of you here have been significant contributors to the Law Society's submissions on bills and proposed new laws. The Law Society is an active participant in law reform. It's actually one of its regulatory functions. And it was a year and a half ago when I joined the Law Society, and it was one thing that really struck me when I joined was both the quality and the quantity of the Law Society's law reform work. And it's only possible because it relies on the hard work and commitment of close to 200 expert lawyers who volunteer their time and their knowledge for the benefit of the profession, but also the wider community. On average, the Law Society makes around 100 submissions a year, as well as appearing before select committees and liaising with government officials. I'd just like to highlight a couple of barriers that I think are to effective consultation that I've seen. The first is inadequate timeframes for consultation. So just thinking at the select committee stage, in practice, I think that select committees often give 6 weeks for consultation. But sometimes this period can be shorter. For example, the Electoral Amendment Bill had a consultation period of 9 working days. And even 6 weeks could be too short, I'd say, for major pieces of legislation. For example, the Land Transfer Bill was a comprehensive and complex rewrite of existing law. And 6 weeks was simply not enough time for the Law Society to prepare its submission. It sought and was granted an extension. So I guess the question I have is whether there should be a reasonable minimum period for consultation to enable the public to have input on proposed new laws. The second thing I wanted to highlight was when select committee scrutiny is bypassed altogether. One of the most concerning uses of urgency is when it is used in a way that avoids a bill being subject to normal select committee scrutiny and allows passage of the bill through all stages. For example, the Returning Offenders Management and Information Bill last year was introduced and passed through all stages in 2 days. And back in 2013, the New Zealand Public Health and Disability Amendment Bill was introduced and passed through all stages in a single day. I'll just leave you with those thoughts and turn now to accessibility of law. Access to justice is an important issue for us all. It's a broad and complex area, and it's not just about representation by a lawyer. It's also, as we've heard from other speakers, about understanding the essence of the law, knowing rights and obligations. Access to the law, to understandable law, is a large subset of access to justice. But how can we achieve this at a time when people are overloaded with information and have ever-decreasing attention spans? The Law Society, for a number of years, has published law awareness pamphlets that are available in community law centres throughout New Zealand, as well as other community organisations. And we recently started posting clips on our website, video clips, explaining the key points of our submissions on law reform in an effort to get out the key messages to the public. Law enforcement agencies also increasingly view education as an important part of their role. And many are looking for innovative ways in which they can get their messages across to the general public. And I'd like to tell you about one of those examples. Earlier this year, the Commerce Commission launched a series of animated video clips. The series was called It's All Good, and it featured New Zealand's sharpest legal advisor, Auntie, and her nephew, Herman Faliafa. And their debut appearance was aimed at raising awareness of people's rights following the introduction of new credit laws last year. Each episode in the series featured a situation that many people would find themselves in their lives, whether it was getting a loan, being a guarantor, facing repossession. And the animations were developed with the advice of the Ministry of Pacific Peoples. The episodes were available on YouTube, and what was interesting was how it was promoted through social media. And I'm told by the Commerce Commission that since March this year, those video clips have had over 340,000 views. And I'm guessing, although I don't have the evidence to back it up, that many of the people looking at those video clips weren't people who traditionally engaged with the Commerce Commission. So my point is, I think that we can be creative and innovative in how we engage with people so that they understand their rights and obligations. So when the mother in the story asks her daughter now to guarantee her loan, hopefully her daughter remembers that funny video clip that a friend shared on Facebook recently and makes a mental note to find out more about what being a guarantor involves. And public consultation about credit law through summits with lenders, regulators, community organisations, together with research, led to a better understanding of how people were making decisions in practice in this area. And as a result, changes were made to the credit law that gave lenders new responsibilities. So now when the daughter goes to the lender's office to guarantee her mother's loan, the lender has to help her make an informed decision. And the lender also has to check that if the worst happened, that the daughter could afford to pay back her mother's loan without suffering substantial hardship. So, to conclude, the economist and neophyte law reform in me would make three conclusions. The rule of law is critical to economic growth, and that includes having a well-functioning justice system. A robust evidence base and accessibility to the law reform process through effective public consultation are key ingredients in ensuring our laws are effective, efficient, and avoid unintended consequences. And finally, we must, I think we'll all agree, improve accessibility to the law, including access to understandable guidance. And I think we need to look for innovative ways of doing this. For example, harnessing the power of storytelling and social media. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fazleen. Again, a very interesting address and good for the lawyers amongst us to be reminded fairly constantly, really, about the impact of other disciplines on the work that we do, and in particular, that of economics. Our final panellist is Dr. Bridgette Toy-Cronin, Director of the Legal Issues Centre at the University of Otago. I invite you to speak to us, Bridgette. Thank you.
It's a great privilege and honour to have 10 minutes at the podium to speak to such a distinguished audience. So in the interest of accessibility, brevity and plain English, I have chosen just one argument to make to you today, which is this: that genuine access to the law, more often than not, requires the assistance of an individual or organisation who's skilled in legal reasoning and advocacy. And this may be somewhat preaching to the choir, but at a time when there is this increasing push towards everything online, I think it is a point worth making. I want to argue this in the context of all forms of access to law, by which I mean access to legal information, access to dispute resolution, and access to participation in law reform. This is not, of course, to argue against all the efforts that are being made to make law more accessible in online forums, but it is just to argue that personalised support, advice and advocacy is necessary to translate those foundations of access to law into genuine access to law. So turning first to access to legal information, As we've heard, there is being a lot done to put more law online to make it more accessible. But it's worth remembering that a lot of legal information remains hidden behind two types of walls. One, pay walls, an electronic legal information through the publishers, and also through physical walls in the form of Law Society libraries, which are only accessible to members of the profession. Academic articles are also similarly hidden behind paywalls because we, unlike the UK, do not have a rule that requires open access publication. This is a real problem, both in the fact that it is preventing people in the general public having access to a lot of legal information in a way that's searchable and is easy and coherent to use, but also because of the message that it can send the community that lawyers have privileged access to legal information, and I think that's a problem. And it's not just providing legal information that is essential, but it's also the provision of assistance in interpreting that information. I think the medical profession provides a good analogy in this situation. Nowadays, when most people experience some sort of symptom, the first reaction is to Google it. And if you do that, you'll get a lot of information. Having read through that information, you might decide to do nothing, or you might decide to treat yourself, or having been confronted with a list of terrible and rapidly fatal conditions, you may decide to go and see a doctor. And going to see a doctor is a relatively cheap and simple thing to do in New Zealand. It's free for a lot of the population who don't have much money and for children, and it's inexpensive for those of us who do have incomes that can bear the cost. At the moment, however, New Zealand does not have the equivalent for legal advice. We know that there is some legal advice which is available free of charge through the excellent work that community law centres do, that people offering pro bono services also offer, and that there is some limited access to legal aid as well. But it is nothing like the sort of accessibility that is required for that information to be translated into something that equates with genuine access and understanding. I think, and my research would suggest, that failing to provide that kind of advice is a kind of cruelty because it leaves people to fall back with no other choice on their informal networks, which often give misadvice, or to leave them to their worst 3 a.m. imaginings. And this occurring can cause people to become frustrated, alienated, and overwhelmed by the system. The help of skilled individuals is also needed to help people access dispute resolution services. There's a trend that's been referred to about the publication of self-help material, and even better, some of the self-help videos and things which show people what the system can do and how to access it. While this trend towards providing more information can help people understand the system, and I think that's a very good thing, it can never substitute for individualised advice about people's particular situations. And that's for a couple of reasons. One is because, as I think it was the Minister of Justice referred to, we live in an extremely complex society. Advanced capitalism relies on complex legislation, and it is completely beyond a reasonable request to think that the population, who have got many other responsibilities towards caring, employment, their communities, could be able to try and understand that level of complexity. The second part of complexity is not just in the complexity of the language that's sometimes used in law. Of course, the plain English movement's very important and does a lot to make the law less opaque. But there is complexity that goes beyond being answered by hyperlinks to a glossary at the end of a self-help guide. One of the deep problems in complexity is the type of legal reasoning and analysis that we as lawyers engage in. And while lawyers are fond of believing that their legal training has sharpened their thought and honed their general analytical reasoning, Elizabeth Mertz, a US socio-legal scholar, argues that education that we undergo in law school is really a shift to a very particular way of thinking and talking, where lawyers become expert in the profession's specialised way of processing information. These skills that most of the people in this room here have learnt cannot be reduced to a self-help guide or a self-help video. At best, it can make the system clearer, which is important, and I fully support the Solicitor-General's comments about trying to educate the public about what the system's capable of, and also for courts, what the courts are not capable of doing, what the limits of their powers are. But at worst, self-help information can give the impression that the system can be easily navigated by people, and when they're confronted with the reality of the complexity, that can cause people again to become frustrated and alienated. Just as self-help resources cannot be a silver bullet, but only something which can assist, nor is the much touted and now snappily called ODR, or online dispute resolution, a silver bullet to everything. The England and Wales example, which is being widely discussed at the moment, boasts a help for those using the interface of the proposal is that there'll be, you know, online chat or phone services to help people use the interface. And while that might be useful to some extent, it doesn't overcome the fact that people using an online dispute resolution service would need to be able to reduce their argument to its legally salient facts and to be able to pick out that it is a legal issue and to put it that way. The system that's being proposed will only have oral hearings when there is when it's sufficiently complex or important, and therefore there's a great need, even when using a system like that, to be able to use those skills of legal reasoning and advocacy. My short point being that access to law requires access to information and to dispute resolution, but it must be accompanied by access to people who can interpret and advocate on behalf of others. Having touched on those two areas, I now just want to briefly turn to law reform. That's not only because this is, of course, a symposium about the Law Commission's work and access to law reform, but access to law reform is a fundamental arm of access to justice. It's only through access to law reform that the population has an opportunity for more fundamental change in society. It's therefore perhaps the most important of all. Access to law reform requires, again, access to skilled individuals to span the gap between the community and the process that's put forward for consultation. In many ways, we've got an admirably clear process for making those consultations, both through the parliamentary process and select committees and through the Law Commission. And the ideas of using Facebook and things are also very helpful. But as an excellent Australian study found on participation in law reform, the level of knowledge and skills usually involved in law reform participation, including functional and law reform literacy, legal analysis, policy and or research, and advocacy skills, are beyond the capability of the overwhelming majority of the population. We therefore need a diverse and large civil society to be able to span that gap between people who need to put their voices forward in the law reform process and those processes that make it more accessible by way of having online communication. To conclude, I just want to emphasise that I'm in no way arguing against many of the innovations which have been discussed and that are taking place. My point is only that as we do rush towards these, as the rush towards these innovations gains momentum, as it certainly is internationally and is increasingly here, we must not be complacent and congratulate ourselves that we are providing access to law. Genuine access to law must be paired with access to skilled individuals steeped in the arts of legal reasoning and policy reform to interpret, to apply, and to advocate. Until the age of robots is upon us, after all, he aha te mea nui o te ao, he tangata, he tangata, he tangata.
Thank you, Bridgette, and an excellent note to finish on in terms of bringing these threads together and realising that there isn't one simple answer to the issues that we've been discussing. We now have an opportunity for questions, and two of our Law Commission people, John Luke and Catherine, are roving with a microphone, and you may direct your question to an individual speaker or just pose it to all of us, and I'm trusting that someone will respond. Yes.
Kia ora tātou, anga mihi nui ki koutou mō ngā kōrero. I thought it'd be an error not to speak. My name is Julia Faipoti and I'm the kaitakawanga for Community Law Centres o Aotearoa, so I work for the National Body of Community Law. I'm also here with my other pōtai, our Chair Just Speak, and we do criminal law reform mahi. I want to pick up on something you said, Dr. Around access to justice requires access to law reform. And absolutely agree with that and want to point out with the thousands of clients that we see every year who can't afford to see a lawyer, and thank the legal profession as well, because we rely on 10% of our legal profession who volunteer for our services, that our law reform services got cut because it was something that a voice was... there's political interest in that space. And so I guess that raises an issue of how does effective law reform and access to justice look when there are, I suppose it's compromised. Access to justice is at risk at the moment. We've seen changes to legal aid, which has pumped the number of people who need our services. And also at the same time where resources aren't increased. I suppose I'm just chucking myself on the panel now instead of posing questions right now, but I feel I need to do this. I'm also in a role, access to justice assumes two things. I'm a kaitakawanga, so I'm to improve access to justice for Māori, because we know that the law does not apply equally, and that's the same with access. So I just put a challenge out there to our Law Commission. There should be a Māori Law Commissioner always. But I'll leave you fellas to think about that. But I just want to mihi to you, because your kōrero really resonated with some of the challenges that we see and experience, and that the starting point in access to justice is probably fundamentally in the education around civics and how that's lacking, and we really aim to provide plain English language law. And you put the challenge out there is how do we design systems that effectively allow access to justice? And I suppose I've just, now that I've given my 10-minute panel kōrero, that challenge, and I'll put that to you actually, like how does that look when there seems we're in a political atmosphere, and this changes year to year, but how can we have access to justice effectively and have that system designed by people who need it the most when we're subject to political atmospheres and things, you know, access to justice, you don't have access to justice if you don't have access for the most vulnerable people in Aotearoa. So I'll just throw that out there, and if you can pick out a question and answer in response to any of that. Kia ora.
Thank you, Julia. Una, do you have a comment?
Well, kia ora, that was very well said, so perhaps next year you'll be invited to be on the panel. I think, you know, you say, what is the answer? I think we're here today trying to grapple with the answer lies in a whole range of different places, in empowerment, in education, in pro bono work, in the profession doing more. I wouldn't want to put my penny down on one answer. There are plenty of places where we need to do better, to make sure that the law is accessible, that the law reform process is accessible, that the political process by which law reform can occur is accessible, all those things, there's a lot to do. And happily, we've got a Law Commission to help us independently and to think about some of the big system blocks that we might be able to work on. The others might have something to say.
Bridgette? Right, Bridgette seconds that.
I don't think my microphone's going.
Thank you. Any more questions? Oh, sorry, John, let's got the microphone for you, thanks.
I thought the analogy that...
I think it's on.
I don't know if I'm on, but I thought the analogy that you made with GPs was a really useful one, Doctor. How would you envisage that being funded?
Sorry, I think this microphone is... I think we need to go next door maybe to ask that. Please hear that, how this one's going. I don't think it can be funded easily. Again, it's the whole thing that the Solicitor-General was also referring to, that isn't a silver bullet. My concern, I guess, is that there's a lot of energy goes into one thing, but it has to be paired with something else, more legal aid, but also perhaps much deeper look at how we can do alternative types of funding for legal services, which some of those were referred to. There has been crowdfunding, by the way. Planet Key litigation was crowdsourced funding. So those sorts of things, there's, you know, unbundling of legal services, litigation funding, all sorts of different models. We probably need to get a lot more adventurous there and have different forms of legal advice billing. Yeah, probably more legal aid would help as well.
Anyone else before we take our lunch break? We're all hungry. Okay, well, I will draw the session to a close. It's been fascinating, and I thank all our speakers, and Fiona in her absence as well, of course, for the time and effort and thought that you have put into your speeches and the issues that you have raised. There is, as has just been confirmed by Julia's comments and by Una's response, there's plenty to think about. I think what came through for me as a real theme of this discussion was the notion that citizens are living the law, and we can't forget that. And in all that we're doing, from all the different avenues that we come to our involvement in the law, and in particular in relation to law reform, people are the threat, to quote Una, and that has to be the driving idea behind what we are doing. So thank you very much. That's been a wonderful session. Thank you.